Thanks to Ground News for helping support this episode. You are traveling at the speed of light right now, though it might not seem like it. Maybe you're sitting in a chair thinking you're at rest. At the fastest, you're on a plane. That isn't the speed of light, is it? The problem is you're not thinking four-dimensionally. You're only thinking of your speed through space, when you also have a speed through time. If we consider them both together as a space-time speed, then the speed of all matter, including you and me, is the speed of light. Hey, crazies. What we're talking about is something called four-velocity, which is just short for four-dimensional velocity. But to understand what that is, we're going to need to start in three dimensions. Regular old velocity, also known as three-velocity, is a way to represent two things simultaneously: how fast something is moving and in what direction it's moving. That's why we represent it with an arrow. It's the speed and direction. It's pretty straightforward, and it's a very useful way to look at velocity, if you never intend on going beyond three dimensions. For that, we need to think like a mathematician.
We're going to generalize things to death.
First, if we draw the path, we can see the velocity is always tangent to that path. Is that like how you go off on a random train of thought sometimes? Actually, that tangent uses the word metaphorically. We're using the older, more literal definition. Tangent comes from the old Latin word tangere, meaning to touch. In our case, velocity is always along something called a tangent line. That's an imaginary line touching our path without crossing it. The velocity is along the tangent line at every point on the path. It's something universally true of all real velocities everywhere. But that's just the direction though, right? I mean, what about the speed? Speed is the length of the arrow, which is determined by another rule. It's usually measured in miles per hour, or kilometers per hour, or meters per second, something like that. A unit of space divided by a unit of time. And that's not a coincidence. Speed is defined as the change in location divided by the amount of time that change took. In rigorous mathematical terms, that would be written like this. X stands for location, T is time, and each of these D's just means a tiny change. So this is a tiny change in location divided by a tiny passage of time. If the change in location is larger in the same amount of time, then the object is going faster. Visually, we represent that with a longer arrow. So far, this is all a bit geometric, though. We need something better for physics. Thankfully, all the way back in 1637, René Descartes invented the coordinate system, a mathematical tool that turns geometry into algebra. It's such a powerful invention that we named the most basic type after him. They're called Cartesian coordinates for his Latinized name, Renatus Cartesius. Anyway, coordinates allow us to write things like velocity as an array of numbers. You just draw a few axes, one for each dimension, and then project your velocity arrow onto each of those special axes. Those three values are unique to that specific speed and direction. If the velocity changes, then those numbers change accordingly. Okay, sure, but how does this apply to four velocity? Time is just a dimension, so it gets an axis too. We're used to thinking of time as uniquely different from space. It's measured using clocks, whereas space is measured with rulers. But over a century ago, we learned that space and time are very similar. Not exactly the same, but similar. So similar, in fact, that we can visualize time the same way we do space, as a coordinate on an axis. As time passes, everything is just moving forward on the time axis. Think of it like the perspective of some omniscient deity or something, but in our imaginations. In this four-dimensional space-time, a path shows us everywhere an object will be and when. We can see everything it will ever do, within our ability to physically predict. That's why every point on a path like this is called an event. If we draw tangent lines at each of those events, we know the four velocity will be along those lines toward the future. Because that's what velocities do. Why are the lengths of all those arrows the same, though? Because of a weird quirk of reality. Say there's a space-walking astronaut and a rock. Since we see the astronaut as stationary, we know we're using the astronaut's coordinates. Her coordinates also include a clock, which measures coordinate time in this picture. But the rock has its own clock, which measures its own passage of time, its proper time. And if that rock is moving relative to the astronaut, then its clock will tick at a different rate. This is the four velocity of the rock written in the astronaut's coordinates. This is the spatial speed, which is why it looks a lot like the three-dimensional speed from earlier. This other one is the temporal speed, the speed through time. Just like before, this x still means location, but more specifically, the coordinate location, as in the location measured by the astronaut, because that's who the coordinates belong to. The t is time measured by the astronaut, also known as coordinate time. This weird-looking t on the bottom is actually a Greek tau, which represents proper or personal time, as in the time measured by the rock. When we're working with four-dimensional space-time, we're working with relativity. Things like time, space, and velocity are all relative to the observer. That's why we need two different times in these equations. One is for the rock, and one is for the astronaut. Why aren't there also two sets of space coordinates? Because the rock doesn't move in space, according to the rock. From the rock's perspective, the astronaut is moving instead. But that's not the perspective we were looking from. Our coordinates belong to the astronaut. Time passes for both the rock and the astronaut. But the rock only changes location for the astronaut. The bottom tells us which object we're looking at. The top tells us who is looking. From there, it's just a few more lines of math. I go through them in my book if you're interested. But I think I can give you a more intuitive understanding in this video. Say we were to graph the rock's proper time against its coordinate location. That's time measured by the rock and space measured by the astronaut. This is super unconventional. I think it'll help in this case, but I would not make a habit out of it. Had the rock been sitting still, its motion would be directed along the time axis only. It would only be traveling through time. But she sees the rock moving. You might think the arrow would stretch to include a change in location. That's not what happens, though. In relativity, the faster we see something moving, the slower we see its personal time pass. The arrow doesn't stretch, it just turns. Any gain in spatial speed is matched by a loss in temporal speed. No matter how fast an object is going in space, the coordinates conspire to keep the tip of the arrow on this circle, and therefore the length of the arrow the same. That length is the speed of light. Well, technically it's the imaginary I multiplied by the speed of light, but close enough. There's just one problem. This graphic only works for spatial speeds less than the speed of light. At the speed of light, the whole thing breaks down. Remember when I said this? This is super unconventional. I think it'll help in this case, but I would not make a habit out of it. Photons move at exactly the speed of light through space. Fast! By this reasoning, it's lost all of its time. Photons have no proper time. They have no anything. For photons, nothing exists. That's why we call their paths through space-time null paths. Every one of their four-dimensional vectors, including four velocity, is zero at all times. You can see how this doesn't really feel like a speed, even though it's defined the same way. So, do we all travel at the speed of light? Kind of. Our four-dimensional speed is the speed of light, but that's only true for matter, not light. And that's probably not what people think of when they hear the word speed. If a factoid sounds simple, it's probably at least a little wrong. That's why it's so important to be diligent when you hear a new piece of information, especially when dealing with current events. Ground news is a great tool for anyone who wants a more data-driven approach to their news. Every story comes with a quick visual breakdown of the political bias, factuality, and ownership of the source's reporting, all backed by ratings from three independent news monitoring organizations. Take the story about interference in scientific research, for example. Right away, you can see that 18 sources have reported on the story. The reports are entirely by center and left-leaning sources, which honestly isn't that surprising for a science story, but I like being able to see the sources on screen along with their lean. You can see the factuality ratings for each along with their ownership breakdown. In this case, 100% of the sources reporting on this story are owned by media conglomerates. My favorite part is a feature called My News Bias, which keeps track of your reading habits over time so that you can see and change your own biases. Right now, they're having a holiday sale, their biggest sale of the year through December 31st. You'll get 40% off their Vantage plan. That's unlimited access to all of their features, including that My News Bias I mentioned earlier. If you're interested, get Ground News for just $5 per month by going to ground.news/scienceasylum. Or clicking the link in the description below. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. There's no such thing as a uniform gravitational field. While that's technically true, it's still useful to discuss. Earth's is approximately uniform on human scales. If you make your system small enough, any gravitational field can be uniform. And that drastically simplifies the math. Anyway, thanks for watching!